face and listen to this voice, you were tuned in to the best kept secret in sports talk. I'm your friendly neighborhood smoking. You are officially on the hot seat. And what are we doing in the hot seat? God damn it, we celebrate World Series championships. God damn it. That's what we do over here, baby. Yes, sir. Congratulations to my Atlanta Braves for winning the 2021 World Series. 21 years, man. That's a long goddamn time. But God damn it, it's here, and we finna party like it's 1995. Yes, sir, I'm still celebrating, and I was celebrating until they crowned another World Series champion. I was telling y'all last show, man, I had no faith in Alex Anthopoulos when he got hired. None. And boy, oh boy, oh boy. I always marveled at the job. What's the kid name that came from the Red Sox and went to the Cubs? Theo Epstein. I always marveled at the job Theo Epstein did with the Cubs. But man, listen, what AA did with the Braves is probably the greatest GM job I've ever seen in my life, at least in the sport of all baseball. Never seen nothing like it. Man, the deals he pulled off to keep this team competitive, to get them over the hump. Hey, listen, tip my hat to you, man. Thank you. Proud of them guys, man. I have to apologize to Mr. Brian Snicker. I was wrong. I said the Braves would never win the World Series strictly based off the way how you manage bullpens and things of that nature, but I was wrong. Here we are, World Series champs, and I owe a great deal of it. We all owe a great deal of it to Snit, because Snit made some unpopular decisions, but they end up paying off. Not going to get into what they were because this is an Atlanta Braves show right now, but hey, listen, man. We are the champions, my friends. Take it, Freddie. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Congrats to my Atlanta Braves again, man. But y'all know why we're here. It's time to talk about Florida State. Listen, guys. I've said this before. I pride myself on being honest and telling y'all the truth. I pride myself on giving you an outlet that isn't driven by the powers that be, sponsors, things of that nature. I'm uncut, I'm uncensored, I'm raw. You know what I'm saying? I pride myself on that. I pride myself on telling you things that other people are scared to tell you. This is going to be one of those shows. So, buckle up. I know y'all come for the gospel. And I got something to give you tonight. So, paying homage to the ghost over my left and my right, let's dive into it. Florida State fresh off another loss to the NC State Wolfpack. That goddamn game was atrocious. From the start of it to the end of it, that game was atrocious. You can say the defense played well. They had their moments, but I don't really think anybody played up to their potential. That game was bad. The offensive line played like shit. Is Robert Scott hurt? He got his ass abused by people I've never even fucking heard of. Robert Scott got his ass towed the fuck up. O-line in general played bad. I know they're dealing with some injuries, and it's not a lot of depth, but God damn it. How many times did you see somebody beat an offensive lineman when it was just three down linemen? You know, they getting home with just three pass rushes, man. God damn, we still having fucking trouble hiking people. Ninth game of the season, we still having trouble snapping the fucking football. My goodness. This whole thing about McKenzie Milton playing, the way the game looked, I'm not even certain Mackenzie Milton practiced. I'm not even certain Florida State practiced this past week, right? I don't think Mackenzie Milton knew he was starting until before the game. I don't think Mike Norvell knew Mackenzie Milton was starting until before the game. I don't think the receivers found out Mackenzie Milton was starting until after the goddamn game because they ass didn't show up either. Like, and I'm, it's so many ways I can go with this. So many goddamn fingers to point. Nobody played well. Nobody coached well. I'm tired of singing this fucking song. I really am. Something got to give. This isn't even frustration because you have to coin another motherfucking word for what I am or what probably most Florida State fans are at this moment. It's not frustration. You were past frustrated because you want to see things trend in the right direction for once, and just when you think things are, they aren't. Okay, so I'm watching the game, right? And don't get me wrong, Mackenzie Milton missed throws. I don't expect perfection out of my quarterback, but, you know, the targets that you are able to hit, you should hit the motherfuckers. But I think the biggest drive killer you can have, outside of penalties, of course, are goddamn drop passes. The number of footballs Florida State receivers get their hands on, not just in this game, but Mackenzie Milton started games, period. The games in which I've seen Mackenzie Milton start and or play in, the number of drop passes blow my fucking mind. They are drive killers. And I don't know if there is a good time to drop a goddamn football, but they drop passes at the most inopportune of times. It's the shit that you think would be routine that Florida State is failing at consistently. And it's the same people failing at these things. Listen, man, something has to fucking shake. We have to see something different. I think a microcosm of the Florida State season happened in this two-play sequence. So, what is it? Third and goal from the two. Here you have Mackenzie Milton under center. The guy with one leg, as they say. You let him go in on a QB sneak. Very next play. Here comes Jayshon Corbin and Wildcat. Same down in distance. He scoots in for a touchdown. I remember when it happened, I asked myself, why in the fuck didn't you run the play that you ran on fourth down on third down? And, you know, it's not a big deal because Florida State scored, right? To you, it's not a big deal. Let me explain something to you. Florida State isn't good enough to have lost or empty downs. Florida State isn't good enough to drop passes. Florida State isn't good enough to miss receivers. Florida State isn't good enough to have mistakes throughout games because they are not in a position, they don't have enough talent, the team isn't well coached enough to overcome those mistakes. That's my problem. If you were going to run Wildcat on fourth down, the last down, why in the fuck didn't you run it on third down? How arrogant are you? This same fucking play calling arrogance is what lost the Jacksonville State game. How arrogant are you to just think or assume that this play, which makes the most sense, why in the hell are you asking the quarterback with one leg to run QB sneaks? You didn't get enough of that shit when you played Wake Forest? Why are you asking him to do that? It doesn't make good sense. That two-play sequence to me it just sums up the Florida State season. It's a bunch of head-scratching shit that goes on. The last two or three shows, you've heard me discuss in detail about the marriage that the players and the coaches need to have with one another. It seems like they just cannot get on the same fucking page. they won't help each other out. And that was a prime fucking example of it. Why would you expect Mackenzie Milton to score on a QB sneak? Even if he does have two legs, he's this fucking big. To where you have a running back, you have two running backs who have really good vision, just put them in the position. And it's not even a personnel all the time. Sometimes it's a decision making. I don't know if it was because of depth reasons. I don't know if it was because of lack of fortitude because you don't want to have an uncomfortable conversation. Explain to me how Akeem Dent stayed on the field after this play. There is no way in West Hill Akeem Dent should have kept playing. None. Because that shit. It's football. It's football. It's a contact sport. You have a safety that did not want to make contact. You cannot keep playing after that. The only excuse is bodies. We don't have enough bodies to take somebody out and put somebody in. If that's the case, fine. I get it. But if you did have enough number of people to substitute, it wasn't a depth issue. If there wasn't a depth issue at safety, he should not have played anymore. At some point, you have to lay down the foundation on what's acceptable and what's not acceptable. God damn it, that's not acceptable. You don't arm tackle running backs in this league. He knows that. He is refusing to be physical in a game where physicality is the number one detriment to success. You don't want to be physical, you lose football games. Just that fucking simple. You know how they say the game is won and lost in the trenches? Because a lot of it has to do with physicality. A lot of it has to do with who's more physical. He didn't want to tackle him. Well, son, if you don't want to tackle him, you can't play anymore. This shit ain't hard. You're making it hard. It's not hard. You know what? I'd have lived and died with whatever. Even if it was a depth issue, there's another fucking cornerback that can go out there and do that shit. Plug his ass in there. This is my issue with what's going on this season. Player and coach alike. They are one and the same. They are no different. They both get the brunt of whatever it is that I'm giving. Shit is unacceptable. You cannot continue to tolerate. You know what? In the corporate world, you have this thing called a will issue. You have this thing called a skill issue. You're willing to accept a skill issue, right? Because at that point, you're telling a person that I don't know how to do this. That's fine. We can teach you. We can coach that, right? Regardless of what your skill set may be, we can still coach you up. We can still get you in a position to succeed in the corporate world, right? You can learn these things. What you don't tolerate is a will issue. Because that means you're telling me you are not willing to do what we're asking you to do. That's fine. I got no problem with that. If you are not willing to tackle, that's okay. No problem with that. You can be willing in the fucking parking lot. You can be willing at another goddamn school. Your unwillingness to do these things, it can exist all the fuck you want it to. You can be unwilling to do those things somewhere else. Not in Doak Campbell. Not wearing a Florida State uniform. No, you can't. These are the things that someone needs to address. Namely, the head coach. And you know what? I wanted to address this at the end of the season because it's not fair to talk about this type of stuff mid-season. But it's kind of like he's forcing my hand. I think it's time we discuss what the fuck does Mike Norvell do well? And it's not a rhetorical question. Feel free. And I'm not saying he doesn't do anything. I'm not being a dick here. I'm not saying that that's nothing he does well. But the things you don't do well seems like they are starting to outweigh the things you do well. Here's an example. seems as if, depending on who you ask, which is most people, Jordan Travis gives this football team the best chance to win. People, a quarter of the season was gone before the head coaches, before the head coach even realized that shit. Want to know how I know? Because I saw that same Jordan Travis line up at running back. Make it make sense. Because some of you people out there are willing to die for Mike Norvell. You know what? Single ladies and single guys, find you somebody who loves you just as much as some of these folk love Mike Norvell and love making excuses for his ass. Help me understand. It seems as if, say it again for you, it seems as if Jordan Travis gives this team the best chance to win. Why the fuck was he playing running back at some point during the season? I had this question last season. Seems as if Jordan Travis was the best quarterback on the goddamn roster. Why did we not find that out until Rotomaker had us looking like the worst goddamn team in college football? We were two or three games into the season. It's your job. This is what they pay you to do. Yeah. You look at the decision making and how it's starting to, not how it's starting to, how it has affected Florida State. Everybody wants Adam Fuller gone. It ain't no goddamn secret. Everybody. You brought him here. You brought him here. Which one of y'all want to take the blame for Jacksonville State game? Huh? Which one of y'all? Which one of y'all want to take the blame for the Jeff Sims, Georgia Tech game, first game of the season? Which one of y'all? You brought him here. It was your decision. It wasn't your first decision. I know. That's a whole nother conversation for a whole nother day. But ultimately, you brought him here. So you're on the hook for it. How you want to do this? If we're keeping it a buck, Florida State has three defensive coordinators. Yes, Florida State has three defensive coordinators. Same thing with the goddamn quarterback position. If you got two quarterbacks, goddammit, you ain't got one. If you got three defensive coordinators, you ain't got one. What the fuck are you doing? Who's calling the plays? You or Kenny? Which one is it? If both of you all are calling plays, something is wrong with this picture. Because if you call him plays, what the hell you need him for? If you have to interject and say, hey, listen, I'm sorry, if you have to intervene and say, hey, listen, what you're doing isn't working, why isn't it working? It's almost as if he's an extension of you. You brought him here. From Auburn, no less, an SEC school, somebody who you trusted, somebody who you think y'all share the same brain damn near. He was with you at Memphis, and you know, you have a relationship, you trust him, you bring him here, and it seems as if y'all are on two different pages, at least with play calling. He recruits his ass off. But when it comes to that goddamn football field, when it comes to X's and O's, and somebody said some shit the other day about he does a great job of scheming people open. What the fuck have I been in? What goddamn game are y'all watching? Scheming who open? We begged Florida State to be your goddamn running football team three, maybe four games into the season. Why? Why did it take that long for you to understand that this is what this team does well? Why are you so goddamn reactive instead of being proactive? Nobody is paying you to be reactive. Nobody. His decision-making is, again, I keep saying starting. It's not starting. It's really fucking shit up. That's not to say he hasn't made some good moves. He's made some really good moves that I really like. But nobody pays you to do half the goddamn job. He was said to be an offensive mind. Whether you like McKenzie Milton, whether you like Jordan Travis, I've seen this goddamn offense this season look really, really bad, pedestrian, and mediocre with both quarterbacks. You mean to tell me you can't do shit with now one of them? Last year I got it, right? COVID season. You didn't have a true off season. You didn't have a true season. You strength and conditioning coach. Didn't have a true off season with the kids. You were not able to implement the thing that you wanted to. It was a fucking mess. I get it. What the fuck is your excuse now? Because I said this shit yesterday. It's starting to look like 3-9 is very, very realistic. Some of y'all don't want to admit this shit. Some of y'all are shaking in y'all goddamn boots because we are starting to approach the first game looking like the 21st game area. We're starting to arrive to that same shit Coburn said about why he released Willie Taggart. It's coming up for Mike Norvell. Whether you want to believe it or whether you want to discuss it or not, it's right around the goddamn corner. What, we 3 games away from that conversation? I'm okay with having it now. Does the first game look like the 18 game? Yep. Sure as hell does. I've seen no improvement, and I mean none. Y'all can sit here and brag about him being organized all the fuck you want. How much organization have you seen translate to wins on the football field? Let me know right damn now. I'm okay with being wrong. My ego isn't that big. I'm fine with. So if you can prove to me that, you know, you've seen the organization translate into more wins, then goddamn it, show me. I haven't. What the hell does Mike Norvell do well? You can't be an offensive mind and this team look as bad as it does offensively. No continuity, no structure to the offense. It seems as if there is no game plan. You just go in and you fucking wing it. And if you don't, you mean to tell me you practice this shit? You mean to tell me that this is the game plan? You studied this shit all week and that's how it looked? This team has more talent than just 3 wins thus far this season. And we can also, I think we can all agree that we can place some of the blame on the feet of the coaching. Yeah, I'm sticking by what I said. I do believe he needs 3 seasons. I think any coach needs 3 seasons. Sometimes you can argue 4. But as it looks right now, and things can change in the drop of a dime. But God forbid this team goes into the next season. I shouldn't even be talking about the next season right now. But God forbid this team goes into the next season with Jordan Travis as a starting quarterback. I mean, if he does, may God be with us. I'm literally at a loss for words of how bad that could be for the program. And that's how it's looking. Why? Because the kid you handpicked left. Why did he leave? Because of the mismanagement you had with the kid that you handpicked. Hey, listen, the last guy didn't do too well with the quarterback room. It seems as if this guy's no different. And didn't set the circumstances, different situations, granted, but you need a good quarterback. You haven't signed one yet. Well, I think Trevor could have been. I think he was good coming out of high school. What he would have been as a college quarterback, I don't know. Got A.J. Duff in the fold. We can all just pray and hope that he signs and he pans out to be everything that we want him to be. But as of right now, we don't fucking know, and Trevor is gone. The guy you – let this sink in. The guy you handpicked is gone. It ain't like he was gone after 3-4 fucking years. He stayed for probably, what, a year and a half? If that. The guy you handpicked is gone. There are conflicting reports about why he left. But none, regardless of what you choose to believe, this is what you can't mistake. This is what you can't confuse. He's fucking gone. You know how bad that is? He's said to be a QB whisperer. Sure the fuck ain't. If he's a QB whisperer, the guy's on the goddamn roster, deaf. He's not. And I'm not trying to pound on him for losing Chubba Purdy, even though it may sound like it, but, and I say that because of this. One thing we forget in the process of all this is still the rebuild. And one thing about rebuilds are they aren't pretty. There are going to be some things that happen inexplicably. There are going to be some things that happen we don't too much care for, right? The issue with that is this shouldn't have been one of them. You understand? Coming into this season, you gutted the roster. You did something that hindered the previous coach. The previous coach couldn't do what he did so quickly. He was able to gut the roster and bring in an influx of guys who he handpicked out of the transfer portal. So I remember saying before, you really had no excuses, and that still stands true today. How the hell did you go out and get guys you wanted and still fuck this up the way you did? And I'm not saying the season should have been sparkling good. I wasn't expecting no goddamn 8-win season. I've been on the record saying that. I believe that, for again, number one, this isn't a 3-win team. I think there's more talent than that. But also, this team doesn't look like it practices sometime. You know, I left the game Saturday wondering, asking myself, Saturday afternoon, is this guy a good coach? And right now, if you put a gun to my head and force me to answer, the answer is no. Good coaches don't produce what he's produced 2 years in a row. Ain't no two ways about it. I don't give a fuck how you slice it. Whatever excuses you want to throw out there, that's your business. I'm not an excuse laden person. Now, I do think that things happen that are out of your control. I do believe that, but he's had a lot of resources at his disposal that he either A, has either mismanaged, or B, he hasn't taken advantage of, and the program is suffering because of it. And just to go back to the game for a minute, just to drive home my point, when you look at the fourth down call that everybody was questioning, I didn't have a problem with the call. I like aggressive coaches. I remember a lot of y'all was killing Jimbo about going for it on fourth downs, and now here you are shitting your goddamn pants every time he goes for it on fourth down now. But the call wasn't my issue. It was a sequence of plays that led up to the call. You know, like, you knew you were going for it on fourth down two or three plays prior to the actual fourth down call. And it was only 4 yards. You, on second down, you know, third down, you didn't make it easier for Milton or that team to get those 4 yards to get first down. There should have been a running play inserted somewhere in there, even if it was just a matter of Jayshon Corbin or Trayshon Ward falling forward to get a yard or to get – because the play call you call on fourth and – four, it probably isn't the same play call you call on fourth and one, fourth and two. You follow me? It was how you went about going for it on fourth down. Even though, you know, Williamson probably should have caught the ball, not disputing that. Even though you probably want Ontario Wilson to be more aggressive in going after the ball on fourth down, whatever the case may be. My issue was you not helping the team get a converted fourth down, right? These are things that I think people miss and they get lost in the wash and you just sweep it away. It's not the fourth down call. It's how are you going to about making these things easier? There should have been a run on one of those plays, at least one. But it wasn't. You see what the offensive line is doing or not doing. You see the issues, whether it's McKenzie missing a receiver or wide receivers dropping footballs. The play call was fine, right? I think you kind of want an inside slant at that moment, but I'm telling you that they've done nothing for the entire game to let you know that their play was going to be successful. Like, people, I don't think you all understand how important this Miami game is. Yeah, I said the biggest game of his tenure thus far was the Notre Dame game. Looking at how the season has gone, it's changed. This is probably the most important game in his tenure because the last guy that lost to Miami was done by the fourth quarter. So, of course, you know, different situations. That's not going to happen with him. But I'm just telling you that the magnitude of this game, with you having recruits coming in, you got guys who you're in it for, you could make or break the recruiting class by how this team performs. If you go out there looking as pedestrian and unorganized and as lethargic as you did in this NC State game, at home no less, the fucking bottom could fall out. Then that's when you could see some cracks in the foundation. And you've done nothing so far to make me believe that you're going to beat this Miami team. Because I remember saying this shit yesterday. We was laughing at this Miami team. We ain't laughing no goddamn more. Ain't nothing funny now. Not a goddamn thing. A lot of the things that you don't do well, they excel at. And you just have to assume that Manning and what is it, Lashley Lachey, whatever the fuck his last name is, the offense coordinator, you just assume that they're going to be smart and attack those areas in which you're not very good at, because it just makes too much goddamn sense. Well, that's it. That's all the time I'm giving. That's all the time I got. As always, people, I appreciate your time. Thank you for stopping by. Thank you for listening, man. Please get in them comments, man. Y'all know how we get down in there. If I don't get back to you, as always, blame my head, not my heart. I am a pretty busy guy. Please like, share, subscribe, share this type of content with people. Share this content with people who you think enjoy this type of stuff, man. Hopefully when we come back next week, it'd be a more positive show. How about that? If not, then I still got my braids. Fuck it. Y'all be good. You officially off the high seat.